Julia Roberts, the hottest actress in America, plays nurse to cancer patient Campbell Scott in Dying Young. It's one of the new summer movies we'll be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert, along with a commentary on whether critics have been too harsh on Kevin Costner's role in Robin Hood. Are the critics jealous of his success? I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. Our first movie is named Dying Young, and it stars Julia Roberts in essentially the same plot as her big hit Pretty Woman of last year. Once again, she's the unsophisticated girl from the wrong side of town who is hired by a slick, rich man who thinks his money can buy her love. Come to think of it, that's kind of the beginning plot of Sleeping with the Enemy, too. Sooner or later, she might find a guy who's nice enough that she'll sleep with him without having to charge first. The only difference is, last year, in Pretty Woman, the man had a cold heart, and this year, he has leukemia. The movie stars Campbell Scott as the cold and manipulative hero who needs someone to help him through chemotherapy and advertises for a, quote, young and attractive woman, unquote, with some health care experience. What he really wants her to treat is his loneliness and depression.
Your father said...
Forget my father.
Well, he said you needed a nurse.
Forget what he said.
Well, if he's the one hiring...
He's not hiring. He's flying to Japan in a luxurious airplane. I am hiring. If you choose to take this job, you will be working for me, not for my father.
By the time he says his chemotherapy is completed, he has developed a need for her that looks a lot like love.
Believe me, it's done. And to celebrate, we are going away.
Where?
Up north. I haven't been out of here for years.
They leave San Francisco and rent a seaside cottage up the coast where, for one scene at least, he develops a sense of humor. To explain his shaved head, Robert tells the locals that Campbell is a Hare Krishna, and he decides to play along.
Well, the truth is, Hillary came along. I was at the airport at United, which, as you know, is the best location. And I was stopping people, giving them a flower and saying, God is love, have a nice day. And then I stopped Hillary. She turned to me, and I knew. I stopped shaving my head the next day. Got in the car and came down here. Probably her favorite vacation spot, right, huh? No.
Nice try, kid.
That'll be $2.50 for the beer, huh?
That's really a howl, and of course, eventually, their relationship begins to change.
Well. But then I have only one thing to give you. My heart. You can have my heart.
You would think that Hollywood would be pretty good at making a formula love story like this, but Dying Young is a dreadful experience. A movie that never for one moment convinced me that these two characters were in love. Campbell Scott is a distant and monotonous actor as the dying man. He's a real drip in this movie. And Julia Roberts doesn't show any of the bounciness and joy that made Pretty Woman so much fun. The movie is cluttered up with a lot of other characters who are never, ever dealt with. A butler, for example, keeps popping up for no good reason. A father who changes totally from the beginning to the end of the movie. But the main characters are no fun to be around.
Yeah, I think the film falls on down on two tests, real simple ones for a love story. One, I never believed that they were in love or really in like with each other. Second, I didn't care whether this guy lived or died. It made no difference to me which ending they were going to go with. Now, when you can say that about a film, that pretty much empties out the whole picture. And you're right, Julia Roberts lights up the screen when she smiles. We know this. Even in that brown-eyed girl sequence where she was trying on all the hats and sleeping with the enemy, I didn't like the picture, but that was a real star turn. Here, very few smiles.
I didn't care either if the guy lived or died. And you know, in one original version of this movie, apparently she goes off with the other character, so he's in there. But because it's not dealt with, he's another... I mean, the movie just ends with all kinds of loose ends with people who are never really followed through on or dealt
but
with.
But that guy, I could understand that ending, because that other guy who works in, I think, near the winery where they vacation...
Yeah.
That guy is an appealing guy. Yeah, he watches too much TV, but he's still an appealing guy.
A lot of people made fun of Love Story when it came out 20, 21 years ago.
Yeah.
Love Story was a superb example of the kind of schmaltz that this is a horrible example of.
That's a good point. Okay, next movie, and it's Kickboxer 2, a sequel to a film I never saw, and this sequel doesn't make me want to go out and rent the original either. This is a fairly standard martial arts material picture featuring young kickboxing expert Sasha Mitchell out for revenge against the Asian champion who killed his two brothers years ago. First, however, we see Sasha Mitchell in action against a kickboxer who cheats. This is like a bad wrestling show on TV. To help him prepare for the big fight against the Asian champ, a Thai fighting instructor is imported. Played by Dennis Chan, he's the film's only moderately enjoyable character.
Pick up the rope. Do you have a firm grasp?
Yeah.
Now tell me what's down there.
Finally, the big fight, which takes place in an empty arena with the villain appearing to be invincible. The fighting sequences seem to be fakey throughout this whole film. You can see where punches and kicks are being pulled, and you can hear the soundtrack being goosed up for the contact. Sasha Mitchell has a nice, easygoing way about him, but this script really offers him no support.
This was a pretty dreadful movie. It's all made up out of parts from other movies. Even the Asian or the Thai instructor is a ripoff of Mr. Miyagi in the Karate Kid movies.
Yeah.
And you mentioned the fighting sequences. The movie was so boring to me that I started really just trying to analyze what they were doing. Did you notice every single fight in this movie is in slow motion? There is no regular motion fight sequence at all.
You mean any big, the big kick?
All the entire fights from beginning to end, all slow motion. Check it out. Now, the announcer is also in slow motion in his voice, and also the ring referee. Illegal move, as he goes like this. And yet, every time they hit each other, it's a sound like this instead of,
are you sure
which it should be, so that obviously the guy who did the sound effects didn't get the instruction or wasn't watching the picture.
I think somebody spiked your popcorn. I don't
know. No, okay. Absolutely true. I would not mislead you.
Okay. 3 months ago, Kevin Costner was a Hollywood hero. Now he's getting the worst reviews of his career for Robin Hood. We'll take a look at the backlash against Costner, if that's what it is, later in this show. And coming up next, The Rocketeer.
Big gopher.
It was like any other day in L.A.
Some clouds in Beverly Hills, but the council voted, decided against it.
A touch of culture. Car phones.
Oh, hang on, just a second. Let me get rid of this other call.
And decafs all around.
I'll have a decaf coffee.
I'll have a decaf espresso.
I'll have a double decaf cappuccino.
Give me decaffeinated coffee ice cream.
Morris, I'll have a half double decaffeinated and half cap with a twist of lemon.
Steve Martin in L.A. Story, coming soon on video cassette.
What do you suppose it is, a bomb or something?
No, it's too complex to be a bomb. I don't see any moving parts.
I wouldn't touch that if I were you.
A young stunt pilot and an eccentric old inventor discover an amazing new personal rocket pack in The Rocketeer, a new movie that would like to be in the tradition of Indiana Jones, but is a lot closer to the tradition of Tom Swift. The movie stars Bill Campbell as the pilot who uses that one-man rocket device to become famous in the late 30s as a figure called the Rocketeer. Scenes like this one have a certain innocence to them, as the hero and his best pal are amazed by this wonderful new gizmo they've discovered.
Thank you.
getting it. I don't know what it is, but I'm getting it.
With flights like this, the Rocketeer becomes a media hero and attracts the attention of a Hollywood star played by Timothy Dalton. Undercover, Dalton is a Nazi spy trying to steal the rocket. Okay. Paul Sorvino is the mobster he hires to help him do it.
You don't need my services anymore. You can take it from here. And I tell you what, you pay me what you owe me because you're half a lunatic anyhow.
Yes, shoot! I want that rocket, Eddie. Not next week, not tomorrow. Now.
To get to the Rocketeer, Dalton tries to seduce his girlfriend, Jennifer Connelly. Campbell warns her of the danger she's in.
Listen to me for a minute.
Jealous. You found out that I was here with Neville and
no,
you said...
No, I'm not jealous. Listen, Jenny, Bigelow's been murdered.
Murdered?
You remember at the studio what I told you about the rocket we found? Well, the people that are looking for it murdered Bigelow to get to me. And now they're after you.
The climax has the Rocketeer in a showdown with a Nazi Zeppelin and a lot of special effects.
Up on the dome! It's him! It's the Rocketeer!
Watching The Rocketeer, I was reminded of the cheerful and simple-minded science fiction thrillers of years ago, like Buck Rogers, Flash Gordon, even Captain Video. If movies like Indiana Jones were inspired by the old Saturday afternoon serials, The Rocketeer is more like a copy of them, right down to the wooden, grade B acting of Bill Campbell as the hero. The Rocketeer doesn't have any charisma as a character, and the plot's pretty dumb, but in an innocent way, this movie is good-hearted and entertaining, and I liked it, but I wish it had a little more edge to it.
Well, I think the point was not to have too much edge to it, save for the fact that they do treat the Nazis as true bad guys. They don't trivialize them. There is, within this picture, quite an amazing little fake documentary Nazi film that was done very, very well. So they're not just trotting them out as cardboard stock villain figures. I thought that the picture, I thought you had it exactly right, that it is more Tom Swifty and Buck Rogers, not the hard-driving Spielberg kind of picture. It's getting out some complaints from people that it isn't that way. It isn't supposed to be. It's more gentle. It's. I thought it was a lot more fun than the last Indiana Jones picture.
I had some questions about that Nazi propaganda film. It shows hordes of Nazis flying in their one-man rocket suits across the Atlantic to conquer America. Now, right. Gene, I had some questions, such as, would you get sunburned if you flew 4,000 miles?
Oh.
Would you run out of gas? Would your heels get singed by the rocket exhaust?
I don't think
Would you be in any condition to fight after you were strapped to a rocket pack and you flew across the ocean?
Let me tell you something. The film, one of the tests that this film passes for me is that it was very entertaining and a lot of fun, and it didn't bother me that we don't figure out why the Rocketeer, with those jet flames coming out of his can, doesn't burn his legs. It's never dealt with, and I didn't care. I thought the picture was joyful.
They're saving that for the sequel. Coming up next, a drama about a feisty old woman who is anything but a typical sweet old movie lady.
That's Scylla Chelton as Tati Danielle, a French aunt who is anything but your standard aged movie character. Hardly a sweet old lady, she is actually a mean-spirited witch who terrorizes her help and the nephew who is forced to take care of her. I respect the difference this film represents. I just don't understand the character's motivation. Here we first meet the old lady as she bullies her housekeeper.
Mais qu'est-ce qui se passe? Vous m'avez fait une frayeur.
L'eau sucrée, j'ai la bouche sèche.
Oh, vous me tuerez.
Eventually, the housekeeper is put out of commission by Tati Danielle, who moves in with her nephew and his wife, who in turn leave her with the new housekeeper as they prepare to go on vacation.
Je voulais vous présenter Mademoiselle Vonnier, qui va s'occuper de vous pendant les trois semaines. Jean-Pierre, vous avez déjà parlé d'elle.
Bonjour, madame.
Bonjour, madame.
C'est une demoiselle, vous pouvez l'appeler Sandrine.
Tati Danielle meets her match in this new nursemaid, even though she pulls such stunts as pretending to wet her bed.
Bonjour. Votre petit déjeuner est prêt. Faire votre chambre.
C'est pas vrai.
Okay, so Tati Danielle is a jerk. I just never saw the entertainment value in this portrayal. I'm not sure why she is behaving this way. Chemical imbalance, maybe, or maybe she is just a jerk. I guess at the bottom level, I don't understand why her story is really worth telling.
Well, you would never ask that question about a story about a sweet old lady. And I think that the answer
if it were boring,
would be,
I would.
I think the answer would be the same in both cases. This is a character study of a very particular person, and it's a black comedy, Gene, in which eventually this woman meets her match and meets her comeuppance, and two people who deserve each other find each other. And in a world that's very imperfect, Teddy Danielle, who is trying to make it even more imperfect, eventually reaches some kind of a conclusion in her life.
I understand, but the comeuppance, which would be, if the battle joined were between two interesting figures, I'd buy it. I mean, that's obviously what's intended here. Frankly, my heart went out to the nursemaid and Teddy Danielle.
The nursemaid was no nicer than Teddy Danielle. That's the whole point.
Well, I think that she was a little bit nicer.
But to give her a couple, another 40 years, and she'll be Teddy Danielle.
Yeah, she isn't gunning for people like Teddy Danielle is.
Well, Teddy Danielle's have more practice. When we come back, a look at the Robin Hood phenomenon. This is a movie the critics hated, but the public may disagree. On this program last week, Gene and I both voted thumbs down for Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, and so did most of the nation's other movie critics in reviews that singled out the movie's star, Kevin Costner, for special blame. The critics didn't much like his accent or his screen presence or his understated tone of voice or all of the up-to-date political attitudes in a movie set in the 12th century. Now, this was the same Kevin Costner who only 3 months ago was being showered with praise as the man behind the Academy Award-winning Best Film of the Year, Dances with Wolves. That was also a politically correct film, and Costner was a similarly progressive hero in it, but the critics liked it as much as they hated Robin Hood.
You're King Richard's cousin. You can get word to him of Nottingham's plan.
What is the matter here? I think there are two problems. Costner is miscast as Robin Hood, and the movie was made before it was written. Because Costner emerged as such a major Hollywood hero in Field of Dreams and Dances with Wolves, maybe Hollywood thought he could play any hero, even Robin Hood. Costner has often been called a modern Gary Cooper, but think what a lousy Robin Hood Cooper would have made. It's a totally different acting style. Here, for example, is the understated Gary Cooper.
I sent a man up 5 years ago for murder. He was supposed to hang, but up north they commuted it to life. Now he's free.
And here is Errol Flynn, not a better actor, but certainly a better Robin Hood.
Welcome to Sherwood, my lady. What, Sir Guy? No greeting from you? Why, that's curious. I've often heard that you'd give me a warm welcome if ever we met again.
Or, in modern times, here is Sean Connery as Robin Hood.
This is my forest. I'll live here as I like. You come in again. I'll kill you.
And compare Connery's fire with Costner's laid-back delivery.
Surely the Lord has the charity to spare a few barrels for good Christian men. Yes? We have much to celebrate.
Well, if you wish to share in the good Lord's brew.
The bottom line, I think, is that Kevin Costner was simply wrong for this role, and maybe the filmmakers never had a chance to find that out because the movie was rushed into production before the screenplay was even finished. The critics are blaming their dislike of Robin Hood largely on Costner himself, but my respect for him is completely undiminished. He is a good actor. This time he was in the wrong movie. I didn't like Robin Hood, but I don't think that's Costner's fault. I think it's the fault of a system. Of course, the public spent $25 million last week going to see the movie. I guess all that really proves is that they love Costner and they hoped it was going to be good. I think it could have been a lot better with a different star and a better screenplay. But just because Kevin Costner is the most visible person in the movie doesn't mean he should take all the blame.
Not all the blame. I tell you what I sort of resent. As a critic, I don't sit there gunning for somebody. I mean, I look forward to his involvement. I mean, he hadn't let people down. So this whole notion, and I think it has to do possibly with the Warner Brothers publicity department smarting from a lot of negative reviews. They go on the attack and say, well, $25 million gross versus those critics, you know, the people that really hate the movies, the critics. They're all, we're not people that hate the movies. We want them to be good. Mm-hmm. We see them all. They don't, you know. And I think that we didn't care for the picture. End of story, you know. And we'll
end
see what
the story. We're looking forward to Costner's next film.
You got it. We'll be back with a recap of the movies we reviewed on this show.
To play Heinz Ketchup's Great American Picnic Game, find a new clear squeeze bottle of Heinz Ketchup. Next, look through the back of the bottle and see if you've won a prize, like a new Jeep Cherokee and more. take the winning label and mail it in. Heinz Great American Picnic Game. You could be one of up to 2 million winners. Airmail optional.
Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this show. Two thumbs down for Dying Young with Julia Roberts and Campbell Scott as lovers without any real chemistry. Two more thumbs down for Kickboxer 2 with slow motion fight scenes we really hated. Two thumbs up for The Rocketeer, a lighthearted and entertaining action fantasy, and the split decision on Teddy Danielle, which I found much more convincing than Gene did. And so, the only one we agree on is, at least Rocketeer. Positively, is The Rocketeer.
Yeah, I think that's a very enjoyable film. And one person we didn't mention was Jennifer Connelly, who plays the heroine in the film. I think she's a very good actress. She's obviously cast in part because of her stunning physical beauty, but I think there's a real actress there, and I like her very much.
I liked her in The Hot Spot, Dennis Hopper's film earlier this year, which is now out on video. I really thought she was really good.
Also, I liked her in John Hughes' Career Opportunities, a picture that was completely bombed, but I thought that she was very, very good.
Okay, that's it for this week. Next time, we'll be back with reviews of more new summer movies, including a pair of sequels, Terminator 2 with Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Come with me if you want to live.
And The Naked Gun 2.5, The Smell of Fear, with Leslie Nielsen and Priscilla Presley. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
Aveeno is not a beauty bar, but what it does for a sensitive face is simply beautiful. Cleanse with an Aveeno bar every day and you'll see. Ah, Aveeno. Enjoy a wild, wonderful swing and sing an adventure with a Walt Disney classic, The Jungle Book, now on sale at a video store near you. Cherokee, an American original. Shoes and apparel for an unusual combination of fashion and comfort in junior, missy, petite, and women's sizes, furnished by Cherokee. Shout now, wash later. Shout sticks it to stains and keeps them from setting till wash day. Tough stains don't stand a chance when you shout them.